السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد رسول رب العالمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، انفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا أرحم الراحمين. والله teach us what benefit us, increase us in knowledge, in good morals and in good deeds ya رب العالمين. I urge you and myself to have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be aware of the reality of this life, which is a temporary life that we should not be deceived by. We are still commenting on Surah Al-Kahf by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings, and we are on the ayah إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا. As we mentioned in the previous ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling His beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ إِن لَّمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. You, O Prophet, about to grieve yourself to death over their denial if they continue to reject and to turn away from you. You're about to grieve yourself to death over their denial if they persist and if they continue to reject. So in this ayah, it's clearly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam not to overburden himself and just to convey the message. Then the next two ayat, as we mentioned last time, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah is telling subhanahu wa ta'ala, surely we have made whatever is on the earth as adornment for it. As adornment, ornament for it. Why? لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. So that we test them. So that we test them. In order to test them, who are the best among them in doing the good deeds? Who are the best in doing the good deeds? لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ and surely we will وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا and surely we will make whatever is on it on earth صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا. We will make it and reduce it to barren ground. We will make everything on it vanish. So it will turn to be like a barren ground that has no plants, has nothing after it had the green scenes and had the plants and the life. It will be reduced to nothing. It will be reduced to barren ground. So this is clear that again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is consoling His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, telling him all of this life will be gone and all of this life will turn to nothing. So don't overburden yourself and don't grieve yourself to death over them because they're rejecting you. I have made this life as a test for them. So some of them will believe and some of them will reject. Some of them will be deceived by the ornament and the adornment of this life and some of them will not. So, and of the things that made our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam really grieve over them and sad for them is that they know his truthfulness, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They know his amana, they know his akhlaq, they know his history among them. He lived all of his life among them. Still, they did not respond to him. And what made him sad is that he was calling them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to their happiness. To their happiness in this world and in the next world as well. Islam is not only about the hereafter. Islam also to make you happy in this world as well. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not ask them for any reward, did not ask them for any compensation, did not ask them for any need or anything, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yet they rejected, they turned away from him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is consoling him, comforting him, telling him that don't worry, don't overburden yourself, and all them and all of what's on this life will be reduced to barren ground, and all of this life is temporary and is a test. So he's reminding him of these facts, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one of these narrations that show us that they knew that he was right, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he was truthful. Imam al-Tabari, for example, he narrates that Abu Jahl said to one of the Arabs one day, "Wayhak, by Allah, I know that Muhammad is a truthful person, and he never lied. وَمَا كَذَبَ مُحَمَّدٌ قَطٌ." Who is that? Abu Jahl, the enemy, the worst enemy of Muslims, the Pharaoh of the Ummah, as the Prophet called him in some narrations, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He said that this is the Pharaoh of the Ummah. He rejected to believe to the last breath, and he was the worst enemy. Yet, what did he say to some of the Arabs? He said, "Muhammad never said a lie, never told a lie. But if the clan of Qusay, they took the liwa, they took the siqai, they took the hijab, they took, if they take, means the clan of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they're responsible for providing water to the pilgrims, to take care of the house and all of these honors and rituals that are related to Hajj, they are all taken by the clan of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then what will remain for us? And in addition to all that, they want to take prophethood. What will remain for us then?" So it's all about worldly things. It's not about rejecting the truth. It's not about rejecting him because he's not truthful. No, it's rejecting him because it is against their own desires. In another narration, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam met Abu Jahl one day and he shook hands with him. Then a man said, "How are you shaking hands with this sabiq, with this person who changed our religion and who's..." Then Abu Jahl said, "By Allah, I know he's a prophet. But how can we be followers to the descendants of Abd Munaf?" Means how do you want us to be like followers, that they are the leaders and we are their followers? No, we're not gonna follow him. We're not gonna follow him and be like subservient or be like followers to him. Again, it's not an issue of like they're accusing him to be a non-truthful, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but it's about their own worldly desires. The ayat continues consoling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, telling him that Allah made all what's on this earth just a decoration for it, ornament, adornment, and this is the nature of tests. Some people will submit to their own desires. They will be controlled by their own desires, and they will use these decorations and these adornments, they will use them in the way that does not please the one who gave them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people will use these blessings that Allah has put on earth, will use them in a way that does not please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some people will be drowned in the ni'am and they forget about the mun'im. Some people get drowned in enjoying these blessings of Allah and these bounties and they forget about the one who gave these blessings to them, the one who gave these ni'am to them. So those are the ones who will lose, and this is ingratitude. This is juhud and kufran of the ni'mah. This is ingratitude, and that is the ultimate loss. Imam al-Qurtubi mentioned that this ayah came to console the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, telling him, "Oh Muhammad, don't be concerned for this world and for all of its people, because we have just made this as a test for its people, and some people will reflect and will believe, and some of them will reject, and then the day of judgment will be ahead of them, and so don't overburden yourself over them, because we will bring them to account." So as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that he decorated this world or this earth with all what it has, just as he decorated the heavens with what? With the stars, as Allah says in Surah Al-Mulk. He decorated this earth with so many types of foods and drinks and plants and houses and valleys and mountains and rivers and trees and amazing sceneries, amazing natural scenes and gardens and orchards and beautiful voices that you can hear, and gold and silver and minerals and animals, horses, camels, all these amazing things. Allah puts all these for what? As adornment for this life. So it will be attractive. It will be appealing to people. And that is the test. How will you be tested? If Allah did not put things that are sweet in this life, then how He's going to test you and test me? So He put these things. And these things are attractive and nice and sweet and appealing. And all people are inclined to it. As the ayah says in Surah Ali Imran, زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ. The enjoyment of the worldly desires for women and also for men from the side of women. For women means for the marriage or the sexual desire, if you like. And children and accumulated treasures of gold and silver and fine houses and cattle and fertile land. All this has been made appealing and attractive to people. Then what does Allah say in the rest of the ayah? ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, all of these pleasures are the enjoyment of this worldly life. Means what? Means this is just temporary. These things are just temporary. But what is with God, what is with Allah, is the finest destination. وَاللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ حُسْنُ الْمَآبِ. What Allah has is the best, is the real life, is the eternal life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made all of these things as a test, as a trial, to see who will be the one who's doing good deeds. Who will be using these things that Allah put on earth in the way that pleases Allah, and consequently, in the way that will give you eternal happiness. Some people will use them in the right way, and will make them as a way to their happiness, will provide and take provision from these things in this world, and also from the things that Allah has given them. Allah has given you strength, Allah has given you time, Allah has given you thinking, Allah has given you sight and hearing. The other day I visited one of the brothers. He's a young, strong man, mashallah. He was hit by a car. So when you look at him in the hospital, you see all of that strength. Where is it? He cannot even say a word. He cannot even move. And this is why you have to be aware that you're not going to have all of these things all the time. So make use of them. Make use of what Allah has given you. As our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Sayyidina Ibn Umar in the authentic hadith, one day he put his hand on his shoulder and he said, be in this life as a stranger or as a passerby. If you're coming to this town as a stranger, or you're just passing by and your destination is another state, will you sit and reside in this town and buy a house and make business? Or you're just going to take the little things that you need, maybe just some food just for you to just continue, and maybe you just fill some gas, right? You just fill some gas and continue, right? You're not going to sit here and buy houses or make business. That's how you should be thinking of this life. Just take what you need to reach the eternal destination. If you don't, and you just sit here, and you start like, I like to buy a house here, and look, this town is amazing, and you let me also buy this and do some business, and you forget about your real destination, you will lose. You will lose your goal, you will lose your eternal destination, or your main goal that you came for. And this is why Sayyidina Ibn Umar said, radiallahu anhu, he said, إِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الْمَسَاءِ. When you're in the morning, don't sit and wait for the evening, because it might not come. It might not come. Get up and work as if the evening will not come. And وَإِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الصَّبَحِ. And when you're in the evening, don't sit and wait for the morning. And then he said, look, amazing two words from this great student of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, خُذْ مِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. Take from your life for your death.
and take from your good health for your sickness.
Now you can do a lot of dhikr, a lot of dua, you can pray, you can come to the masjid and learn your religion, you can do a lot of good things, you can help your parents and be dutiful to them and honor them and respect them, etc. And you can do a lot of things. But once you're sick, you cannot. So take from your life for your death. As our scholars, they used to say, الدُّنْيَا مَزْرَعَةُ الْآخِرَةِ. This world is the farm for the hereafter. You need to take whatever you can just for the hereafter. You need to plant here so that you take it there. You're not going to stay here all of your life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing us. Who's gonna be drowned in these decorations, in this zina? Inna ja'alna ma'ala al-ardi zina. Decoration, ornament. Don't be deceived by this ornament. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make all this vanish and go away, and the earth will become like without any plants, barren ground, no rivers, no mountains, no plants, no trees, no houses, no castles, no people, nothing. No animals, no gold, no silver, no cattle. This is the reality of this life. Allah made it very clear before us and warned us to be deceived by this world. In so many ayat in the Quran, wallahi, like this topic is a very big topic. If you read the Quran, you will find so many ayat where Allah is setting the example for you. In this ayah, for example, that the desires have been decorated. What does Allah say in the next ayah? After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that these worldly desires have been made appealing to people, look what He said. We mentioned, He said, and what is with Allah is the best destination. Then He said, shall I tell you of what is better than this? For those who are pious, they will get gardens under which the rivers flow. Remaining there forever. That is the key word, dear brothers and sisters. No matter how much you achieve in this world, then what? Then you're gonna leave everything and go. What can you take with you to your grave? These young people who are spending their time just with amusement and PlayStation and maybe illicit and forbidden websites and images and videos and magazines and illicit and forbidden relations, what will you get? What will you take with you to your grave? What will you take with you? You will only take your deeds. Whether good or bad, the bad deeds will accompany you to your grave. And the good deeds will accompany you. So think what you're going to take with you. So Allah says, they will be there forever and they will get pure spouses. And above that, they will get the pleasure from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاللَّهُ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. So some people, they're aware of this life. They have not been deceived by these apparent decorations. They realize the reality of this life and they're using it and taking from it for their eternal life. But on the other hand, some people, they're living in this life just like cattle. And they're amusing themselves and enjoying themselves without fulfilling any obligations, without even thinking about their Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of their concern is to feed these low desires, whether food or sex or any of these low desires, without the guidance from the one who gave them all these things. And these ones, once they have death, and once death comes to them, they'll start... Oh, please let me return to do some good deeds. قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا. قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا. Please, my Lord, return me so that I can do some good deeds. No. Once your time comes, no return. And Allah gives us an example or description of these people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُخِرُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ بِجَنَّةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that He will admit those who believe and do good deeds, gardens under which the rivers flow. Then, look on the other hand. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يَتَمَتَّعُونَ وَيَأْكُلُونَ كَمَا تَأْكُلُوا الْأَنْعَامُ وَالنَّارُ مَثْوًى لَهُمْ. And those who deny and disbelieve, Those who reject and turn away from the guidance of Allah, what about them? Allah is saying, they enjoy themselves and feed like cattle. And then the hellfire will be their home. They're like cattle. They graze in the pasture. And they're unaware that they will end up in the slaughterhouse. This is the example Allah is giving to those who turn away from His guidance. To those who are drowned in the pleasures of this life, and not fulfilling their obligations, and not using these pleasures of this life in the way that pleases Allah. They're just like the cattle. They're grazing and grazing, unaware that they will end up where? In the slaughterhouse. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of the righteous ones. So this doesn't mean in any way to turn away from this world, not to go and study or work or achieve high status. Not at all. But to live and make use of these things to help you reach the ultimate goal. To please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summarized this concept in an amazing ayah in Surah Al-Qasas chapter 28. At the end of Surah Al-Qasas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the story of Qarun. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبْتَغِي فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah, in Surah Al-Qasas, ayah 77, seek, ابْتَغِي فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ. Seek through that which Allah has given you. Seek what? Seek the hereafter. Make your goal the hereafter. From your study, from your work, from anything you're doing in this life, make it all as a provision to help you reach the real life, the hereafter. Seek in that which Allah has given you, your mind, your capabilities, your hearing, your sight, your... Seek what? ابْتَغِي فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ. In what Allah has given you. It's not you, it's not your smartness, it's Allah who has given you the capabilities and the money and the mind, the sight and the thinking and the capabilities. Allah has given them to you. Seek in them what? Seek الدار الآخر. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. And don't forget your portion of this life. So the goal is the hereafter. But you don't forget your portion of this life. Means you work and for what makes you live a good life. وَأَحْسِن كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ لَكَ. And be good as Allah has been good to you. Be good as Allah has been good to you. وَلَا تَبْغِي فَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And don't see corruption on earth. Surely Allah does not love those who spread corruption. These ayat, particularly these two ayat, they are related to the people of Al-Kahf. And this surah is named after the people of Al-Kahf, right? Why? And because the Mufassirin, they said that those young people, they were very, very they were living very luxurious life and they were very rich. Yet, they were not deluded and deceived by the ornament and the adornment of this life. And they preferred to leave everything for the sake of Allah